Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Apologies have been received this morning from Colin Smith. Our next item of business is a decision to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members content? Thank you. So our next item of business is evidence taking on the Consumer Scotland Act 2020, relevant public authorities regulations 2024. I welcome Tom Arthur, Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, who is joined by Heather Gilbraith, Solicitor, and Neil Rafferty, Head of Heat Strategy and Consumer Policy Unit at the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Committee. The draft Consumer Scotland relevant public authority regulations 2024 are extremely straightforward in that they list those public authorities which have to adhere to the consumer duty, the duty. As such, the SSI plays an essential part in confirming to public authorities whether or not they must adhere to the duty. The consumer duty and Consumer Scotland go hand in hand. When Consumer Scotland was established, stakeholder feedback identified the need for comprehensive change in how consumers are considered and integrated into policy and decision making. It was this feedback that paved the way for the idea of the consumer duty. The duty will require relevant public authorities, that is, those listed in the SSI, to have regard to the impact of their strategic decisions on consumers in Scotland and the desirability of reducing harm to those consumers. The Consumer Scotland Act also stated that Consumer Scotland may issue guidance for the duty. Consumer Scotland has helpfully agreed to this as it can see the opportunity provided by the duty. Not only will Consumer Scotland be able to highlight good practice by public authorities in this area, but it will also be able to highlight to Parliament any detriment to consumers. My officials carried out stakeholder engagement before and during the consultation period on the consumer duty for public bodies consultation. Although there was broad support for the duty, there were concerns raised about this being an additional administrative burden and the need for clear guidance. Some stakeholders also disagreed that the duty should apply to their own organisation or body. My officials undertook further engagement in light of these responses, emphasising that the duty was to be applied in a proportionate and targeted way, and only to strategic rather than dailier operational decisions. These further engagements and reassurance have been positively received by the organisations concerned and fully addressed the concerns raised. My officials also looked again at the authorities which were named in the consultation and decided that the duty should not apply to them all. As a result, some of these authorities have been removed from the final list. As Minister for Public Finance, I am well aware of the pressures already facing the relevant authorities, and I am determined to ensure that the duty is not, either in perception or in practice, an unnecessary burden. The guidance being prepared by Consumer Scotland will ensure that public authorities know how to apply the consumer duty to their strategic decisions, ensuring that the guidance captures all the information that those authorities will need will therefore be vital. This is why I have agreed to there being an implementation year to allow Consumer Scotland the necessary time to consult and engage with stakeholders on the draft guidance before it is finalised in advance of 1st of April 2025. Consumers are the lifeblood of our economy. The establishment of Consumer Scotland recognised that simple truth. The legislation before the committee today is an essential part of a process designed to ensure that public authorities put consumers at the heart of their strategic decision-making and thinking. I hope that members will support this draft instrument.
Thank you, Minister. There's now a chance for opportunity for members to ask questions. Can I maybe just ask about the level of support for the purpose of the consumer duty? We did write to the Minister in advance this morning session, and thank you for the letter we received. We did highlight that only 49% of respondents had supported the duty being applied to the bodies as outlined. And in response from the Minister, you do, I suppose, recognise what the concerns are that to do with workload and the guidance, but the letter didn't really address how those concerns were going to be addressed. And you have talked about the guidance, but I suppose my question is around workload and administration. How are you confident that we can get more than 50% we can get broader support for introducing the duty.
I'll ask Neil to come in a moment, because officials have had extensive engagement with public authorities, and as I touched on in my opening remarks, this has went some way to addressing the concerns that they have. What I'd want to reiterate and be clear about is the way in which this duty is applicable is to strategic decision-making, so at executive and board level, as opposed to day-to-day operational matters. Also, the guidance that will be prepared by Consumer Scotland, there will be draft guidance published ahead of the commencement of the duty, and will be a public consultation undertaken by Consumer Scotland, which will of course capture the views of the various bodies that are captured by the duty. So working together and collaboratively to ensure the guidance is most appropriate. But with regards to the engagement that has taken place with public authorities to provide that reassurance and address concerns, I'll ask Neil if he wants to comment.
Mr Rafferty, when you respond, could you maybe, the Minister's letter also said that the consultation responses would be published soon. If you maybe give us an idea of when the timescale for that is, so we'd have a better understanding of what the consultation responses said.
Well, I can take the second part first, and happily say that we've actually published them now. As of the end of last week. Okay. Apologies for taking so long to get round to that, but it has been done now. And as the Minister said, following the consultation, we have had a number, myself and my team, of direct one-to-ones and bilaterals with a lot of the bodies who responded, and some who hadn't, and that included the vast majority who had expressed some concerns about what the consumer duty might mean and its relevance to them as an organisation. And without exception, I would say that those conversations have put those kind of concerns to bed. People are much more aware, organisations are much more aware about what this means and doesn't mean for them. Their ability to use existing processes and assessments to demonstrate compliance with the duty, a better understanding as to why it does apply to them as organisations. So I think that figure, were it to be rerun now, would be a lot higher in terms of people who, you know, might not be overjoyed at the thought of the consumer duty, but at least understand it and understand how they can respond to it in a way that is proportionate and just as the Minister described.
Are there members who wish to ask questions? Brian Whittle, to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. I mean, who can argue with a bill that says they want to reduce harm for consumers? And I don't think anybody would argue that. But I think my issue around with the consumer duty stuff is this consideration of the benefit for, you know, for consumers around reducing harm. How you would define that? For me, you know, reducing harm would be, you know, in a public authority would be, for example, I've got a couple of mental health third sector organisations that are having to close their doors because there's you know, withdrawal of funding from local councils. Closing, you know, that's definitely not going to reduce harm. We've got closing of community programmes and sport and music and art and all those things that are being curtailed. That's not reducing harm. And, you know, local public procurement of food for, you know, schools and hospitals, whatnot, that's been squeezed as well. So that's not reducing harm. So I think my concern here is, one, how you define that, and two, how would you enforce that? Because you couldn't enforce, you couldn't go back to a council and say you can't shut that because of a budget constraints, because it'll cause harm. How are you going to define? Define what reducing harm means?
Well, it's an important question. On the point about enforcement, in terms of the consumer policy, is a split competence between devolved aspects and the reserved aspects. Advice and advocacy are devolved. Enforcement, these are matters that are reserved, so there isn't the means for us to legislate for the enforcement around consumer issues. With regards to how individual public bodies interpret this and respond to it, it's an important point. And it's why we have taken the approach that we have with this focus on the strategic level, but also in not being overly prescriptive, because we recognise that given the broad and diverse landscape of public bodies, the way in which they will be able to apply this duty and take this duty and have regard to this duty will vary depending upon the particular functions and duties that they discharge. So that's why it's important to give that flexibility for the duty to be for public authorities to have regard to the duty in a way that's consistent with their own functions and responsibilities. And it's part of a requirement that is that will be reporting. And that's something that can be incorporated into existing reporting that local authorities do, for example, through an annual report. So with that as well, there will be the guidance that is developed by Consumer Scotland, it's an NMO statutory body with that statutory responsibility for coherence and strategic leadership within the consumer landscape in Scotland. So again, Consumer Scotland, who are directly accountable to Parliament, have an important role to play there. So recognising the limitations upon what we can do in enforcement, it's a collaborative process. We want to work constructively, and Consumer Scotland have an important leadership role to play in that. But we recognise that the way in which the duty is actually had regard to will vary from public body to public body, reflecting their specific duties and functions.
Joe Fraser.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. Just to follow up Mr. Whittle's point, first of all, I do recognise we're only looking at an instrument here that's specifying a list of public authorities. We're not looking at the substance of the bill. But the issue I struggle with is what is the practical impact of these regulations? So, can you give us an example of something a public authority is not currently doing that it would do in future once these regulations are in place?
I can't give you a direct example. What I can say is that there will be things that public bodies are doing at the moment which would have a positive impact, but they might not necessarily recognise or identify that. The duty will bring that requirement to have regard to consumer interests and strategic decision making, and again, referring here to the executive and the board level. And that is something that will certainly be of assistance to Consumer Scotland in that strategic leadership role that they have. But it will also help public bodies in considering their work going forward where issues of detriment may be arising. I would make reference to my response to Mr. Whittle that the way in which that manifests could vary given the sort of diverse range of public bodies that we have across Scotland. So I think this is something which will provide a significant opportunity for learning and to support the work of Consumer Scotland in particular in that strategic role, and indeed Parliament in its scrutiny of Consumer Scotland and the wider devolved consumer policy landscape. Neil, I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add or any reflections from the engagement with public authorities about how they may apply the duty.
I don't think so, Minister. There are some to whom we've spoken who have said, this isn't going to result in us doing or thinking about things that we're not already. So in that sense, it's kind of belt and braces. But there will be other organisations for whom maybe that's not the case, and the consumer duty does inspire a bit more thought and a bit more reflection on how some of the strategic decisions that have been taken do perhaps risk consumer detriment and make sure that's a bit more thinking along those lines. But it's one of the things that, I think will be drawn out both in the guidance but also in practice as the duty is implemented.
Okay, thank you. That's quite helpful. It does seem to me that public bodies should be doing this already. So, in effect, this is just putting into law something that in practice should be happening. Can I ask just one more specific question, Convener? I noticed Transport Scotland are excluded from the list of bodies who are covered by this. What's the reason for that?
I'm slightly thrown by that.
Was this with regards to the
Regional Transport
Authorities? The point, I think we cover this in the letter to the committee, that local authorities who are part of the transport authorities would be covered by the duty. Do we have a list of organisations?
Yes. Transport Scotland
are listed under executive agencies, but it's the regional transport partnerships who have been excluded.
Yes, sorry, that was the point of confusion there. Yeah, so with Transport Scotland and local authorities both being subject to the duty, that was failed to sufficient. I don't know if there's any further commentary you'd want to add to that, Neil.
No, no, it's, I think it's the link to local authorities that, that is the reason why the regional transport authorities were excluded.
Yes.
Yeah.
And is there any other, they were the only organisation who would be in that kind of arrangement, because how would then, if it's about strategic direction, how does the regional transport partnership strategic direction be influenced by the consumer duty? Because they're kind of one step removed with away from local authorities. Or
well, given the role of the Transport Scotland local authorities as delivery partners in terms of their engagement and their work and their strategic decision making, they would have to have regard to the consumer duty. So in effect, it avoids duplication.
Okay, if there's no other questions from members, I'll move to agenda item 3, which is formal consideration of the motion to approve the instrument. As a reminder, only members and ministers can take part in this part of the agenda. I invite the minister to make any additional comments he wishes to make and to move the motion.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Does any members wish to speak at this point? Okay, as no member wishes to speak, I'll put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M11828 be approved. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We are all agreed and the motion is therefore approved. A short factual report of the committee's decision will be prepared and published. I thank the Minister and officials for joining us today, and I briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Our next item of business this morning is the first evidence session of the committee's consideration of post-legislative scrutiny of the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. I welcome Joanne Davidson, Scottish Chamber of Commerce Network, Scottish Chamber of Commerce, Stacey Dingwall, Head of Policy and External Affairs, Scotland Federation of Small Businesses, and Colin Smith, Chief Executive of the Scottish Wholesale Association. Lindsay Millen from Close the Gap is unable to attend this morning and has sent apologies. As always, as members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. The committee decided to undertake this inquiry because procurement is an issue that has come up in a number of inquiries we've done in this session, starting with supply chains, but also our town centre and retail inquiry and various other pieces of work that we've done. And particularly, we want to look at the 2014 Act and see if it's made progress in the areas it was hoping to make progress in, and if there's areas where we're looking for improvements. So this is a kind of general opening question before I allow other members to come in. So there will be a chance to expand on some of the answer you give to me this morning. But I'm looking for the kind of key changes that the Act has made for the businesses that you represent, what's been positive about the Act. So maybe come to Joanne first.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Convener. I think from a Scottish Chambers of Commerce perspective, we have seen some changes. We have seen so that the transparency of the process now is much improved. The obligations that are now on public sector bodies to publish opportunities, the way that they evaluate opportunities, and obviously the reporting that now is done, the annual reporting and the procurement strategy publication is helpful and has certainly opened up the process. I think requiring organisations to report how they're complying with sustainable procurement duty is something that our members see as positive, and giving public sector organisations greater powers to seek information on subcontractors and supply chains is all helpful in terms of bringing opportunities to SMEs, which we consider helpful. However, I think there are still a number of issues which our members have raised with us. There are still a lot of inconsistencies in requirements cross directorates, cross authorities. One Chamber member has given us an example of a bid that they had to write, where they had to write about their sustainability policy. They had to write the same information in three different ways because it was required to be put in three different formats by three different contracting authorities. That's not necessarily good. The information wasn't different, but the way that it had been requested and asked for and had to be formatted was different. So there's an extra administrative and cost burden on that too. Other issues around some of the accreditation requirements that are required, there's a lot of cost involved in achieving those, and they can be onerous to achieve and to maintain, especially for small and micro businesses. And something else that was flagged as an issue is the procurement threshold. So those haven't changed. So still, for goods and services, it's £50,000, as it was in 2014, despite the fact that obviously we are in a very different economic situation. And so there are some issues around things like that. So I think there are a number of other issues. I'm sure those will come out as we continue the conversation this morning. But I think in summing up, one of our members in conversations that I had coming into this session looking for feedback said that they would give it a C+ in terms of if that's helpful in terms of the its performance. But certainly some good progress, but lots more to be made.
OK, thank you. Colin, if I maybe come to you next, would you agree it's a C+, or has it been more positive for your members?
It depends who we're talking to. I mean, obviously, I'm here from the Scottish Wholesale Association representing the wheels to the food and drink industry, the wholesalers that are supplying into the public sector, the local authorities, schools, care homes, hospitals, prisons, etc. Actually, when we were out surveying our members, it was very much a mixed bag, a confusing bag, and certainly one that isn't fully functioning, I'll be honest, and actually some of the changes that have been made through the Public Procurement Reform Bill has actually made it more cumbersome. There's actually apathy and actually businesses, members, producers that are no longer engaging with the process because it has become too cumbersome, too costly. And actually, when we look at the aims of the Procurement Reform Bill, which we actually support, we support the aims, as do our members, and we support the specifically the local food strategy that this also links into. It's actually not achieving the ambitions because it's become too big. The tender framework basically is that you've got to more or less be able to provide the 32 local authorities with their food requirements just to get on the framework. So that takes away the local buying opportunities to have local wholesalers come in and the local producers within those communities. So, big procurement strategies was fine. You know, the idea of bringing all the procurements from local authority into one central framework was good in theory. And it's actually fine if you're buying computers or diggers or something you're maybe replenishing or repurchasing maybe once every 5 years. But when you look at food and the food supply chain, you know, food is eaten every day. Deliveries are getting made 3-4 times a week into the schools, the hospitals, etc. So when you start to look at a national framework, that doesn't work when you're for the frequency of deliveries, the amount of buying that's required. And actually, when you start and then drill down into what the local authority require and the regional variations in their food, you know, Dundee, Tayside, you know, they prefer lamb in their lasagna, who would know, as opposed to beef. and just using that as an example, Tayside, through the three local authorities there, are having to produce or provide 1,200 different school menus. Now, that's horrendous, you know, and that's supposed to be manageable within a framework that's pretty rigid. Not just the framework that's rigid, it's actually the regulations that sit behind that, which actually creates the inflexibility. So we're talking about the nutritional requirements for food and drink in schools. We'll maybe come on to that in a bit more, but that's actually preventing food from getting into schools. It's preventing local producers and suppliers getting in, because actually a bread, and this is a requirement of the nutritional framework, the bread that has to have 3 grams of fibre is not available in Scotland. In fact, it's not even available in the UK. It's been brought in, I think, from the EU. I think I was going to say Belgium, but that's ice cream. But yeah, the bread that is required by the nutritional guidelines isn't available in Scotland. And that's one of the things we need to be working together to give the confidence to the local producers, local suppliers, to make that bread. We've got a market, but actually there's no producer there willing to make it unless they have a guarantee of supply.
Can I just, one of the things you said, so for food procurement, it's the same procurement process if you were procuring computer equipment. It's not targeted.
My analogy was, apologies, I'm not sure what the procurement process is for a computer, but yeah. I'm just saying that, you know, bringing all the local authority procurement teams into one framework to reduce the burden and cost at the local authorities doesn't actually work, because actually need regional procurement teams, so that, because they know what the local school needs, they know what the school children like, what the hospital requires, and, you know, as I've just outlined, the requirements of each region in terms of their food and what people like is different from up in the Highlands and Islands down to the Central Belt. So.
Yeah. Okay, I understand now. Thank you. Thanks. I'll bring in Tracy Dingwall. Tracy, if you want to respond to the first question.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks for having me along today. No, that's okay. That happens all the time. So in 2019, FSB actually published a report which looked at 5 years after the 2014 Act had a level playing field for SMEs with regards to procurement being created. And it also looked at things that had come in prior to 2014 that had really helped SMEs, like, you know, the development of Public Contracts Scotland, the introduction of the Supplier Development Programme. So those were things that were already positive in place before 2014. The report also highlights things like, you know, requiring public sector organisations to have a procurement strategy and to publish an annual report on that, requiring the use of community benefit clauses. There's a whole list of things that the Act did bring in 2014, which have actually been really beneficial for SMEs. Since that legislation was passed, I think we would say that our interaction with public sector organisations suggests there is a greater desire to open up more opportunities to SMEs. However, what we're seeing is that the statistical evidence has not shown that intent has not yet resulted in increased spending with local businesses, particularly at the micro end. There's still not the proportion of spend that you would expect going to these local enterprises.
Okay, thank you, Stacey. I'll bring in Murdo Fraser to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. And maybe I could just follow up your point, Stacey, that you just made about access for smaller businesses. I'm a veteran of this committee in different forms in previous sessions, and I remember discussions around procurement going back many years and the frustrations we would hear, particularly from small businesses, who would always argue they weren't getting a fair slice of the cake from public procurement. And it always used to be the case, and I'm interested to get your perspective on whether this still happens, but it used to be the case that public bodies would in effect hide behind EU procurement rules. Now, of course, we're no longer in the EU, so I'm interested to know whether that issue is still there, whether obviously we're still bound by WTO procurement rules. Is that still a barrier? And specifically, is it the small and medium-sized businesses who are the ones who are still struggling to get a fair slice of the cake?
Well, yeah, the bureaucracy issue is definitely still there. That's the biggest reason that we hear from members in terms of why they don't engage with that procurement process, because, you know, I'm talking about micro businesses, sole traders, it's one person, you know, they're trying to run their business, you don't have time to... I've personally filled out tenders, I know how long it takes. They don't have time to take that out of their business to actually go for these contracts. So when we surveyed our members around about this time last year, 71% of respondents told us that they had never tendered or run for a public contract, with sole traders less likely to have been involved than limited companies. And of those who had gone for it, two-thirds said that they'd found the process to be too challenging for them to navigate. And most of them said that was because the system is clearly set up and geared towards larger businesses.
So both of you are nodding. Joanne, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, no, I would absolutely agree with everything that Stacey has said. I think the cost issue, because time is money, especially in the smaller organisations. I think as well, one of the challenges that our members have fed back is bid writing is a skill, and if you're running a business and, you know, paying and managing accounts and managing people and servicing your clients and doing all that kind of good stuff, there isn't necessarily that skill within the business for you to take advantage of some of those opportunities. And I think there's also there's the actual complexity, and then there's also the perception of complexity, which I think is another challenge as well. Something else that people have flagged to us, in fact several people flagged this, is timing. So one of the things that often happens is a procurement opportunity will come out or be published around about a major holiday period. So the actual physical time that an organisation will have to respond to that opportunity is impeded by the fact that, you know, if they're a Fair Work employer and they treat their staff fairly, then they don't want them working over holidays to complete these bids. So there's a whole range of things, I think, that the process is masking that are real bureaucratic issues, I think, for certainly members that we've spoken to.
Okay, thank you. Just before I come in to Colin, John, just to follow that up, have you noticed an improvement since the 2014 Act was passed?
In
terms of reducing bureaucracy?
I think there, not necessarily an improvement in terms of bureaucracy. I think improvements in terms of transparency and visibility and the procurement, the publication of procurement strategies and reports, I think that's all very positive, but not that we're hearing anyway, certainly in terms of the bureaucracy of the bidding process.
Okay. Colin?
Thanks, Mardo. I agree with everything that Joanne was saying, and just in terms of that burden and time and et cetera, that SMEs certainly don't have it. In fact, the wholesalers who are, you know, dealing with all these SMEs and actually encouraging them to come into wholesale, so the wholesaler distributes into the NHS, the wholesaler themselves don't have the time. I've got one member sitting currently with a procurement contract on their desk. It's going to take one person in their office 3 weeks to complete, to get all the information that's required. And that's the burden of it. So there's no way that an SME is going to have the time, the capacity to do that. So there needs to certainly be a simplification of the framework, of the tender process, and indeed, actually, does it need to be so cumbersome? There is the opportunity, potential, of actually having a two-stage process. But one of the fundamentals is that, and one of the reasons that actually, since the reform of the Act, there's less wholesalers applying, is because it's cost-led. So we will probably come into that, but the contracts are 75% of the weighting is towards the cost of goods. Well, actually, we should be looking at the benefit of cost, because cost and looking... All that happens with the cost of goods is it goes to basically the cheapest, whereas it's not achieving the aims of the strategy in terms of local community wealth building, getting more local producers into it, keeping that pound in the local economy. My goodness, that bread, remember, has been brought in from the EU. If we simplify the process and look at actually the whole food system, we can then actually create economies of scale that encourages more local producers to make the bread, to make the ice cream that I mentioned that comes from Belgium. You know, then creates more jobs, that creates the community wealth that the aims of the strategy are trying to do. And you mentioned about EU procurement restrictions and WTO. That still exists. And I'll be honest, it's partly because Scotland is, you know, trying to align with EU regulation in the hope that it get back into Europe. So that is still hindering the framework and the strategies, because instead of actually saying you need to select Scottish product needs to be the primary choice, you can't, because EU regulation don't allow you to do that. So we're tying ourselves in knots. We want to do one thing, but actually legislation and restrictions are preventing everything that we're trying to do.
Thanks. I'm sure Brian Whittle, who is obsessed by this issue of local procurement, will follow these questions up in due course. Can I ask, go back to Stacey, but slightly different question, Stacey, if I can, because in your submission you talked about issues around prompt payment, particularly for second or third tier suppliers to contracts. How much of that is still a problem, and what progress is being made trying to resolve that so people are paid on time?
Yeah, it's still a significant problem. For our members, I think I mentioned a report that we did last year, which found that it was an issue for about 50%. Over 50% of Scottish small businesses had experienced late payment. And looking at, we do a quarterly confidence index survey of our members. So the one for Q3 23, that had actually increased from 51% to almost 57% in the last quarter had experienced late payments. And that was actually an increase of 25% on the previous quarter, Q2 2023. So it's really a significant issue.
And just so I'm clear, are these late payments coming from public bodies or from other people in the supply chain?
It's not split out, so yeah,
right,
it's okay. A mix. Yeah.
Mix. Okay. Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. Some of the things you've said so far, it's quite a worrying picture, I think, you're painting. Not fully functioning, regulations inflexible, confusing picture, cumbersome and bureaucracy, lots of it. Can you each give us two or three points on how we could streamline things, how we could make things better? You know, what would the future look like if you gave us two or three points? What are we really trying to drill down? How do we make things better for the future? Colin first.
I can give you more than two, and I'm happy to do a supplementary. I think I mentioned about the actual framework and actually potentially having it as a two-stage process to reduce the burdens on those that are bidding. There's no point in everyone having to give supply all the information if actually they're never going to get the tender. So, you know, there's the opportunity of actually having it as two-stage. What that might look like, I don't know. But, you know, a lot of the tenders, and again, it's food and drink I'm talking about, a lot of the tenders, the weighting is 75% based on price, 25% on everything else. And the 25% is never going to have any jot of a difference if it's actually 75% on price. So the weighting needs reviewed so that there is actually more measurement against local supply, local product. And when I say local, I mean Scottish. But albeit it can be in a true local sense, and that would be ideal. So looking at the sustainability credentials, the food miles and journey, as opposed to just the price of it, because going back to that, you know, benefit of cost, your local product, local supply chain, or local producer is going to be more expensive generally, I would suggest, than a mass-produced imported product. But again, if we can give the confidence to those producers and have more of a focus on the framework to ensure that there is more local product coming in, then we can actually enjoy the benefits of that £1 staying in Scotland, which I think is about 2.38, or for every pound you get an extra £1.38 in the local economy, depending on which metric you use. The other one is on training and education, because actually the system, the framework as it's presented just now, started with the end user not understanding the actual food supply chain that sits behind it, how the wholesalers operate. There's no one wholesaler servicing the local authority. There's just in the same way there's no one wholesaler got all their business with that local authority. Those wholesalers are still supplying the high street, the pubs, the clubs, the restaurants, convenience stores. And actually anything, any disruption in that market, as we saw during COVID, as we're going through some troubles at the moment in the hospitality industry, anything in that, those other sectors, then impact on the supply chain going out to the local authority. But that's not being considered. And then when you put in the restrictions that have been put in place in terms of the nutritional framework, there is no flexibility. So actually, let's sit down with industry, with the producers, and look at how food systems work and how actually you can get the food, nutritious food, but actually is, you know, works for everyone and our Delivering Growth Through Wholesale programme that we do to help local producers understand wholesale as a route to market and the requirements of local authority and all the other sectors could actually be developed to help in this process, help educate local authorities, Scotland XL Supplier Development Programme, on actually how food does get from farm to fork.
Thank you. Stacey? We actually see a huge potential in the community wealth building legislation to address some of these issues. So, for instance, looking at the community wealth building pilots, there was 5 of those. And we've been really involved with those, and we have a team of development managers who work in local areas with our members. So the official figures, before I go on to all the on-the-ground aspects, when you look at the stats for those pilots, so Clip Manager, for example, were one of the pilot areas, they set a target in their 2019 strategy to take local spending to 21.5% by 2022, and they actually hit almost 25% by 2021. And also Fife Council, when you look at them, they made significant progress in going from about 22% spend in 2010-11, which is the baseline year that they use, up to over 40% 10 years later. So you can really see the benefit of these pilots. My colleagues tell me that there's 2 factors which have enabled this progress. So that's ownership on the part of the local authority and strategies with clear targets that have detailed monitoring arrangements, which is something that we're calling for as part of the community wealth building legislation for that to be statutory. So, for example, the level of detail that you would find in Clip Manager's annual procurement report tracks progress, so all stakeholders can see what progress they've made, but also sets out concrete actions that they've taken in order to produce and sustain that progress. So when I was actually doing the submission, I compared that with Aberdeenshire's report, whose spend had actually increased by about 2% since 2010. So there was no mention of community wealth building in Aberdeenshire's report at that time. However, I actually checked yesterday, and they've published one since then, and community wealth building is mentioned throughout their latest procurement report. And when you look at their proportion of procurement spend, it's actually increased by more than 2% year on year. So you can see the benefit that setting those targets and having that kind of tracked progress or the ability to track the process has in procurement spend.
Thank you. So, yeah, I agree with those points, but I think from our perspective, more meaningful pre-bid dialogue, I think, would be incredibly beneficial. So meet the buyer events and those types of things are useful, and we've had positive feedback on those, but they don't really go far enough. And I think particularly the more technical or complicated the procurement, the better that pre-bid dialogue should be with potential bidders. I think one example that we were given preparing to come into this session this morning was it's a Scotland XL framework contract for new build residential construction. So what my understanding is that they did there was, before they issued the bid, they went to all local authorities that were forming part of the framework and said, do you intend to put any new build in over the period of the framework? And the local authorities were then able to come back and say, yes, we are, or no, we're not. And then that way, they were able to inform the bidders which parts of the country were going to have those opportunities. And so people were able to self-select, essentially, whether they would choose to bid for to be part of that framework, depending on what was happening in their local area. And if there was the opportunity for there to be quite a large-scale new build piece, then they were able to sharpen their pencils a little. So there was a win-win in terms of both the process that was gone through and the efficacy of that process, but also the public purse, because those bidders were able to look at costs accordingly. So that was one example. Now, obviously, that's a very specific thing, and it's for a large-scale works framework contract. It's not going to be relevant in all areas, but that type of approach, just that sort of intelligent understanding approach, is helpful. And I think the other thing that's been flagged to us on a much more practical level is Public Contract Scotland, the Public Contract Scotland website, which is great, but my understanding is it's a bit out of date now. It hasn't been updated in quite some time. It's a little bit clunky. Can that be improved? Can AI, for example, be used as part of that platform to do some sort of contract matching service, so that it wasn't necessarily particularly for smaller micro businesses, up to them to trawl through and understand and decide for themselves which were the best of fits for them. But there was some way that they were able to be matched with opportunities, or the opportunities were able to be made visible to them. Not to give them any advantage, but just simply to make them aware that these opportunities existed. So those are sort of two, I guess, more practical things that our members have suggested could be improved.
I also noticed in the evidence that we had taken that a focus on cost leaves no slack. This is what we heard in the system for innovation. What's your views on that? What are your members thinking at the present time? There is no slack, no...
Certainly, it was one of the things that I should have said at the very, when you were asking about things that can be improved. I think the issue is actually the local authorities, their budgets are being squeezed, and I fully appreciate. Actually, I should have said at the outset that we understand this is about the public purse. This is public money we are talking about here. But equally, there's problems in how that is spent, and it's not giving the big bang for the buck that it should be. So local authorities, the budgets are being squeezed, but that includes all meals for the schools, the NHS and everything. And it is not even keeping track with inflation. Now, if you think the cost coming through the wholesale channel over the last 18 months, you know, because of everything that we know about from the COVID, Ukraine war, et cetera, you know, we're seeing costs 20, 50%, potentially double on some food items. That's not being reflected in the budgets that are given to the tender process to say, you know, tender for the school meal or you know, whatever it might be. So all we're doing is that drive to a lower quality product. So innovation costs money. Innovation is actually having a Scottish product instead of that product from out with Scotland. That's innovation. We can't afford it because, you know, the budgets aren't there. If local authorities were given the budgets to actually support what the framework's intended to do, or what the procurement strategy is supposed to do, you would get that back in two times. But if we continue doing what we're doing, we're actually not going to be fixing anything. And your food system is going to be broken because you aren't going to have anyone bidding for any of the tenders because there's no profit in it. 1.2% net margin is what the wholesale channel operates on. So when we start and look at costs coming down the road in terms of April, like the wage rate, that is a bit of a crippler for our sector and for the local authorities going forward.
We're certainly concerned. You know, I said our call with regards to community wealth building is to set those targets, but we're fully aware that will require local authorities to provide additional resources for that. So we're probably a bit concerned in the legislation if additional resources wasn't given to local authorities in order to deliver these targets and monitor them. And as well as local authorities, resources will need to be given to programmes like the Supplier Development Programme, which is a really useful tool for our members. And I know they want to do more and could do more, but it's just a question of resources. So I think in order for the community wealth building legislation to be successful, there needs to be that dedication of resources, or we will have this innovation or just achieving what the community wealth building aims are. If we won't be able to achieve it if we don't put those resources in.
Then Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to ask you about the annual procurement reports and how we could make them better. But just before I do that, Stacey, I wanted to speak to you about what you mentioned, the community wealth building. From your written evidence, you highlighted two cases, Clackmannan and Fife, and actually had a look at both their procurement reports, and they were very good. And just to update you, Fife is now at 49% local spend, as opposed to 22% back in 2010. Do you think having that level of detail in the procurement report encourages your members to bid when they see that the trend is to improve?
Absolutely. You know, it certainly helps me in my job to track and, you know, look at what we want to recommend so that we can, as I said, we have those colleagues out in different areas of Scotland who will be engaged with the local authority on their local procurement work, whether it's consulting on their strategy, the development of the report. It's really useful for us in order to be able to meaningfully participate in those conversations, as well as, encouraging members.
Why do you think that a lot of local authorities don't have that level of detail and trend and analysis? Because I've had a look at two or three others, which will remain nameless at the moment, and there was nothing like that level of detail that's in the Clackmannan report or the Fife report.
Yeah, so the Aberdeenshire report that I highlighted, obviously they had addressed those issues with the report that I looked at yesterday, but I think it is, just to go back to that, as the level of resource that people have to dedicate that, it's not there.
Okay.
It's quite interesting, the difference in size between Fife and Clackmannan, because Clackmannan is often a small, well, it is a small council, it's often felt they don't have resources, but they have, you know, you've got one of the smallest ones in Scotland and one of the biggest ones, so often size and capacity is an issue here, but it's obviously not in this case.
But, I think they've chosen to prioritise it, obviously, yeah. You know, they've made that commitment. Which I don't know if that is easier to maybe do in a smaller authority, but it, yeah, I can see, particularly Clackmannanshire, they've really embraced that pilot and they've made it successful, and I think that's why we're calling for that. You know, we look at the progress that different local authorities have made. If you look at the improvement service data, and it's not consistent. So there's some they do really well 1 year, but then they fall back the other year, and it's just kind of a bit all over the place, which is what suggests to us that there needs to be the requirement really for that commitment and the targets to be set so that we can maintain or indeed improve the progress that's been made.
And specifically that your members would like to see in these procurement reports? I mean, are these procurement reports useful, and is there any changes you would like to see in them that would make it more useful to your members?
Yeah, well, I suppose, you know, it's different. What would be useful for me with more time to read these reports than, you know, your average small business on the ground. So, you know, they're not going to read, they don't read our reports, they're not going to read local authority reports. So it has to be, you know, whether it's an infographic or just something that's one page right there.
Page summary.
Yeah.
Yeah. Colin, in your written evidence, you said that not all local authority contracts are being reviewed but simply renewed, preventing new bidders or suppliers from getting the opportunity to be listed. There's no information like that in the annual procurement reports about companies that have bid for a contract and been unsuccessful. Do you think that information should be contained in the report?
I think certainly it would be helpful to understand why bids haven't been successful, because it's only with that you would then encourage others to potentially bid or see actually the flaws of you know, the system. I mean, certainly, you know, building on what Stacey was saying in that discussion, you know, that I think what was just discussed shows that actually it's working in some areas, in some councils, and that's where I was saying at the very start, it's a mixed bag from our members. We have members that is working well for. You know, we've got some that are going, yeah, it's okay, but it needs fixing. There's others that are just saying, no, it's just not working at all. And it's taking those reports that to understand the learnings. I know we always talk about learnings, but really, it is, if it's working in one, then there's no reason that can't be replicated in others. And there is examples of that within our sector, and you know, Aberdeenshire, again, it was venison. You know, we've got a problem with wild venison, but actually it's a very healthy, nutritious, protein-rich red meat. So actually, one of the councils worked with the venison farmers, in fact, Argyll and Bute did it as well, to make venison burgers that are now going, you know, and sausages that are being distributed in schools and going down very well. So there is success stories in there, it's just that there's not enough of them. And that's what we need to look at changing here today, and you know, the recommendations that come out of the committee.
And John, what changes would you like to the procurement?
I think, I mean, I agree with much of what's been said by Stacey and Colin, but I think anything that increases the level of transparency that's available, because that will help to demystify the process for businesses, and it will help to encourage those who maybe have got a perception about it that actually this is something that they can try and do. Some feedback that we had from one of our members was around the publishing of headline figures and those headline numbers. You know, the amount of contracts that are awarded to businesses of various sizes isn't really that helpful. It's about the value of those contracts and how, so if even, you know, if there's a greater percentage of smaller organisations that have been awarded those contracts, what does that mean in terms of value? If it's still very low value, then it's not really progress. So you know, there's a whole host of things around that level of detail. I think the other thing that was fed back to me when I was preparing for this meeting was the length of time that it takes a contracting authorities to award a contract. So very often time frames that are given at the start of a process are given in good faith, and obviously people try to adhere to them. Things happen, things are delayed, sign-off is delayed. So how long is that decision period? How long is that taking? Because that can help as well in terms of planning and resourcing and people deciding on a cost basis whether or not that's work that's worth undertaking. And I think the other sort of element of that as well is maybe some case study work within, you know, some actual stories of procurement exercises. I mean, I'd given the example earlier of the framework, the residential build framework contracts, things like that could be helpful both in terms of encouraging bidders and organisations to engage with the process, but also perhaps in other local authorities or commissioning authorities learning from good examples of what else is happening elsewhere. So that could be helpful too.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Kevin Stewart, be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I should probably begin by saying that I'm a bit of a procurement anorak, and when I was the convener of finance in Aberdeen City, I used to have the PCOS software system for procurement on my computer, which annoyed a great amount of people, it has to be said. But it taught me a few things, and I want to come to some of the points that Colin made first around about frameworks and some of the agreements. I think it would be fair to say that in my day I used to get frustrated when some of these agreements were more in the hands of the solicitors and the accountants than they were the end user of the product. Is that a frustration for members?
Who's solicitors and accountants? Local authorities?
I'm talking about local authority ones in this case.
Yes, I mean, obviously, you know more than me on this one. But certainly, you know, that cost piece I've already articulated is the big stickler here. You know, that we aren't actually, you know, we are looking at the cost of the food as opposed to the benefit of the cost. I'll go back to There is a lack of understanding from local authorities, and you know, even Scotland Excel. And don't get me wrong, Scotland Excel Supplier Development Programme do a good job in what they are trying to do a good job with what they've been given. I think the fact that we've got Supplier Development Programme there to handhold people through the process says that there's actually complexity. You know, if you need somebody to hold your hand, but the cost. Yes, the cost is an issue. It's prohibiting everything that the strategy is trying to achieve.
So cost is always going to be an issue. Let's be brutally honest here. Cost is always going to be an issue, particularly in these tough times. But what you don't want is additional cost in terms of some of the bureaucracies that you've described. And what you don't want is additional cost in terms of procuring products, which at the end of the day might not be the best one. So let me give you an example of where I was coming from around about in the hands of the solicitors and the accountants rather than the end user. Because one of the most interesting things that I found were those folks that were the most canny and knew what they wanted were the school cooks. They knew what they wanted. You could see in the system exactly what they were going for and what they were missing out, right? They knew what was best and following, of course, the guidance at that point. But what you saw at points was the actual framework for the procurement of certain foodstuffs didn't match the needs of those school cooks who I think knew best, because others were involved in the procurement who probably should have kept their noses out, quite frankly. Is that something that you and your members find?
Yes. I mean, going back, so the schools, the chefs, the cooks, absolutely. I think it goes back to they know what they want. The wholesaler's trying to give them what they want, but actually the regulations don't allow it. So if we take, you know, I've used the example of the bread. But that's just one example. There is actually naan bread as well. know, that 3 grams of fibre, the inflexibility that the local authorities have to actually go out and procure what they want is non-existent. So one of the local authorities, there was an Android that was given to the kids with their korma, but it only had 2.3 grams of fibre in it as opposed to the 3 grams.
I think we get the point about this. And basically what you're saying is that some of the regulation that exists does not make sense at this moment because product is not available and it's not what folk want anyway.
No, there's no flexibility, and all it means that the kids aren't getting what they want, so actually they're being forced down the street to High Street to buy the unhealthier choice. And right. In fact, yes.
Stacey, what's your members' view in terms of frameworks themselves? Is there that too much bureaucracy? Is it some of the wrong folk that are putting in place the frameworks and the actual tenders?
Yeah, so as I said, actually, when we surveyed our members, there was quite a small who'd actually been involved in the process itself. But for those who are, bureaucracy is the issue. Our members told us last year that they're spending not just on procurement-related regulation, but 8 hours a week on regulatory compliance. So if they're already doing that and they're not involved in procurement, they're not really looking to take on any more.
Okay. Joanne?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the additional work and the additional cost is one thing, but that even on a framework, there's absolutely no guarantee that someone's going to get a call off on that, and therefore they're not going to get an opportunity. So one of our members flagged a couple of examples to us. One, they came second on a particular framework by 0.25%, and they've been on that framework for 4 years and they've had no work through it. Another, they'd bid for it, I'm not sure if it was a framework contract, but they've described it as a big bid and they lost by 0.17%. Now, I understand that the scoring mechanisms are there, they need to be there. That's, of course, there has to be a mechanism by which these bids are scored and decisions are made. I understand that. But that suggests, you know, an element of I'm trying to use a more diplomatic phrase, but it suggests an element of
Just tell influence. Us what you think.
It suggests a level of influence, I guess, in terms of that decision making. You know, when it's coming down to 0.17%, you know, that perhaps sometimes, you know, that there's an overweight thing, perhaps, to some of those quantitative metrics.
So you talked earlier about there being more transparency. The fact that they're told a 0.17%, is that not a little bit more transparent than it was before?
Yeah, but if the reasons why there was such a small fraction in it aren't fully explained and made transparent, then that's still an issue.
So that comes on to the next part of my question and around about the feedback to unsuccessful bidders. Has that improved? Is there room for further improvement? What do your members think about what they are told after that unsuccessful bid?
For me, yeah.
If you want to start, Joanne, that'd be grand.
Yeah, I think we had sort of conflicting feedback on this, I guess, obviously because of the way that procurement is done and how it's managed across directorates and across commissioning authorities. There are obviously differences in approach, although clearly there are regulations. Those regulations are quite light, certainly from my reading of them, in terms of exactly what should be communicated and when and that sort of stuff. So I think that has been an issue, certainly for a few of our members, is that they've had issues with feedback. Also, I think in terms of feeling like people can challenge, I think there's a little bit of fear around that in case it may preclude them from further opportunities. Now, that's possibly perception rather than reality, but that is an issue for some people in terms of challenging decisions during the standstill period.
So we need to get rid of some of the perception as well.
I think there's a perception issue, there is a reality issue, but there is also a perception issue too in some areas.
Stacey, in terms of that feedback from your members?
Definitely agree that there's a perception issue in terms of, you know, having worked at a job where I had to do tenders every day. There is, you know, when you go into it, you're like, oh, this is going to be a nightmare, but then some of them you get into and it's actually fine. So I think it is about a lot, maybe 10 years ago they went for a contract and it was a nightmare. And it'll have put them off to this day, to be honest. So I definitely think there's an issue there. In terms of the feedback, I've said it to local authorities, patchy, dependent. You know, some will have a good engagement depending on the relationships with the local authority. If it's one of the bigger ones, then maybe there's not those relationships there. But I certainly agree with that point where they'd probably just want to kind of keep their...
again, I'm trying to be diplomatic. I'm trying to just kind of maybe not engage in that and kind of keep their... I can't even think of the word now. Just kind of keep in the background and not kind of bring that attention to themselves in case it does hinder them.
Colin, please.
Yeah, I don't think I've really got much more to add. It is just about the rebuilding the confidence and trust in the system, which is broken.
So very briefly, convener, that feedback being different from different public bodies, 32 local authorities, for example, that in itself, off-putting for folk. Do you think that we should maybe see if we can come up with a more uniform scheme of feedback, again, opening up that level of transparency?
I think community wealth building offers an opportunity, that yep. legislation. There's huge opportunity to address these issues there.
Joanne?
Yeah, I would agree. I think anything that improves the transparency of the system and increases confidence in it is worth it.
Paula?
Yeah, it's just about making sure that the measurements are tangible and actually mean something, going back to, I think, Stacey's point earlier.
Glad. Thank you very much, convener.
OK, thank you. Colin Beattie, to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. I'd like to just take you through a slight retrospective here. I'm going to refer back to Session 5 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee, which heard concerns that the practice of procuring through large contracts could be making it harder for smaller or newer firms to access opportunities. Now, that's despite the practice of dividing these contracts into lots. Now, I assume this is still going on. Do you have views on these practices and how they're impacting on business? And what are some of the challenges that framework contracts can throw up? Maybe I'll just start with you, Colin.
Thanks, Colin.
Well, you're first on the right, you see.
Yeah. look, obviously, we represent, as a trade body, we represent everyone from the large nationals down to the 95% of the wholesale sector in Scotland that are SMEs. And it is a challenge for everyone. The large have a challenge as much as the small. But I think going back to the original point at the start, this framework, the reform actually favoured having a big contract rather than regional, local contracts, where it was then more accessible for smaller producers and smaller local wholesalers to actually bid for those contracts. What happens if you then have a bigger contract that is supplying, you know, multiple, you know, tens of local authorities? That then means that the suppliers that they bring in and put into the schools and hospitals, etc., must have the capacity to be able to fulfil those contracts. But that is not necessarily going to be so for, you know, a small baker or, you know, whoever it might be. They might not have that scope and capacity to service 10, 12, 15 local authorities. They might have the capacity to sell a couple in their local community. So, you know, it has hampered, you know, the ability of smaller producers, smaller wholesalers to come in and bid for the contract. And that's why we need to rebuild the confidence, because prior to the changes, there were more wholesalers and even local suppliers bidding for those contracts.
Can I ask you if this is sort of pushing the smaller businesses into a position where they're subcontracting from a larger business which has taken the main contract?
So some of the larger ones that are winning it are then subcontracting it to smaller. Mm-hmm. So if you look at, you know, the Highlands and Islands, it is supplied by a larger wholesaler, but then they subcontract it to the local regional supplier or wholesaler in this instance. Sorry.
Are there any other issues about framework contracts? Or is that the one big one?
Well, there is many. There is.
Is that the model you've described, Colin? So is that then a positive? Because what you've said is that it needs to be, in order to win the contract, the big is better in some ways. It gives more economies of scale. But then they subcontract to smaller companies. There's that model, so what's the problem with that model? Why is it not advantageous for the smaller companies? Because the big one wins the contract and then they still give supply to the smaller ones. So,
but you've got 32 local authorities, but you don't have 32 local wholesalers supplying into each of those local authorities. You have, you know, some regional supply, but I think a lot of it is on a national supply basis, and that they will subcontract where it's not financially or commercially viable. Where, in terms of the procurement framework or the overall strategy, it's about community wealth building, and where actually we can get more local supply chains working rather than one big one. And it's also about Scotland's food security going forward as well. You know, we need to be providing the confidence to the farmers, to the producers, that actually there is a demand for the product, and you know, we are willing to invest in giving them the confidence to produce. I think when it comes to Scottish product, a lot of it's premiumised. People are quite happy to take a margin on because it's made in Scotland, but that actually doesn't help anything, because it then doesn't make the Scottish product become the primary choice, the first choice. It's still the cheaper, bigger brand. So there is also how we look at where the product is sold. You know, even just down in the cafe in the Parliament here, you know, you have your Scottish soft drink that's at £3.30, but you've got your national brand at, you know, £2.50 or whatever it was. So everything that we're trying to do, economies, Scottish producers, etc., we're actually not helping ourselves by premiumising it and making it prohibitive to anyone to even invest in the,
you know. And so the Good Food Nation Bill was passed in 2022. Has that made any difference or had any impact on the kind of issues you're raising?
No, I mean, it actually is totally interlinked to everything that we are talking about here, and the Good Food Nation is about, you know, those local supplies and producers. But again, it comes back to that confidence piece. If we can use the public sector as the key to unlock the investment that is required by manufacturers, say to them, we have a ready-made market, you can have your products as first choice into the schools and NHS, etc. Then that grows economies of scale, then starts to bring down the cost. And that's partly what that our Delivering Growth Through Wholesale programme is designed to do. It is supported and funded by the Scottish Government. But we need somebody to give some of that scale to build that confidence. I do apologise at going, I say confidence a lot, but there is a lack of confidence in the system. There's a lack of confidence for local producers to invest in their businesses and the jobs and the local community. Because big contracts that we're talking about here are not willing to invest in buying them, because it comes back to cost.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Pitt.
Okay, Stacey.
Yeah, I think that model we kind of talked about, where a larger company gets it and then there's a subcontracting opportunities for small businesses, it can be great, you know, because it does give small businesses that opportunity. However, I think the collapse of Carillion shows what the issues can arise for small businesses when they become part of those really long, complex supply chains. So there is an issue of complexity. But I would say the main issue, which we touched on earlier, for small businesses within the supply chain is late payment. Now, obviously, Scottish procurement legislation does have requirements upon primary contractors in relation to their suppliers, but we feel that there's more needs to be done. Obviously, I've highlighted the ongoing issue that our members are having with late payment. So at UK level, FSB have been campaigning extensively on that for years, and we saw at the autumn statement just at the end of last year, the Chancellor commit to, so from April next year, companies with a turnover of 5 million or more will be banned from bidding for public contracts if they have a record of paying their suppliers after 55 days or more. So we're really looking for things like that, which make it clear to real government, to make it clear to these kind of larger companies that it's unacceptable to treat your small subcontractors like a kind of overdraft facility, to be honest.
Anecdotally, I've heard about large companies taking on the contracts, but completely subcontracting everything. So they're really just managing the subcontracts rather than any products or anything in there. Is that something you've come across?
Personally, in a previous job in the third sector, yes. Working for part of a larger organisation, that was quite commonplace to do that. But I think it's maybe a different approach. If you're the third sector, large employer managing that, they are probably quite likely to have a different approach to their smaller subcontractors than a private sector company might.
It's hard to tell whether it's a positive thing or not that everything's subcontracted to local businesses.
Yeah, it can be, but it just depends on the behaviour, I suppose, of the, as you say, the manager, if they're not doing it themselves.
Joanne?
Yeah, I would agree with what Stacey said around risk to the small provider in those types of situations as you've described, and the late payment issue is definitely an issue. I think the framework contract thing is, we haven't had a tremendous amount of feedback about it from some of our members. I think there are positives from a contracting authority perspective in the sense that then the prime contractor takes on a lot of the risk and a lot of the management of those suppliers, which then means that the contracting authority doesn't have to do that. So from a public purse perspective, I can see some benefits there. But I think the challenges there are around those larger organisations having that localised supply chain and having some rigour about how that localised supply chain has been created and making sure that they've got all the elements in that localised supply chain to be able to deliver the contract. So there's roles for lots of organisations in that. There's roles for Chambers of Commerce, there's roles for the FSB in terms of trying to encourage some of those organisations to look at those supply chains and make sure that they're diverse, they're local, you know, they've got community benefits embedded, etc., etc. So I think that's the only issue to flag there from our perspective.
Are there any successful examples of cooperatives, local cooperatives, getting together on a regional or whatever basis in order to bid? Because that would have the same effect as, you know, having a large company bid and then subcontracting, except it would be obviously kept in Scotland for local benefit.
I'm sure there are. I'm not personally aware of that many. I mean, I'm obviously aware of regional initiatives such as the City Region deal that we have here in Edinburgh and the collaborative approach. It's not the same thing, admittedly, but you know that collaborative approach. In terms of bidding, competitively bidding for a piece of work, I'm not aware of an example, but I'm sure they exist. I'm sure they're out there. I'm just not personally aware of them.
And just one last question. I've been talking to a number of community groups in my own constituency, and they have had experience of bidding for business, and they've had difficulties with navigating the websites, and in one case they gave up because it was just too difficult. Is that an experience that you've had any feedback on, the complexity or inefficiency of the website? Stacey, you're nodding.
Yeah, so as I say, I used to work in procurement, so I used to go on Public Contract Scotland daily, and it still took me ages to navigate my way around it, and that was my job to do it. It's a helpful website, Public Contract Scotland, probably when it was developed however many years ago, but it's a very old website that is very difficult to navigate. As I said, it was my job to navigate it, so at least I was getting paid to do that. But a small business, you know, that's additional to their responsibilities. They're not going to spend the time to navigate that website. It definitely needs updated.
Colin, have you had any experience in this?
I've had no feedback in reference to that specifically, sorry. No.
Joanne?
Yes, and I mentioned earlier actually when Gordon had asked about improvements, or someone had Evelyn, so he'd asked about improvements. Yeah, I think Public Contract Scotland is a great resource. It's a single point of access, which is always helpful, but it is clunky, it is outdated. I think updating that is definitely something that would benefit small to medium enterprises and encourage that bidding culture that we've talked about, bringing in some new technologies, AI, for example, looking at contracts, matching, so that it's not such a labyrinth to navigate, might be helpful too. So absolutely, I would say that's something that should happen, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Just on, if I could follow a quick question from my colleague there around the big contracts and subcontracting them out. I mean, as Murdo Fraser might have slightly alluded to there, I have more of a passing interest in public procurement. I'd heard, you know, for example, in the construction industry, that it is big companies coming in, winning the contract, and then subcontracting out completely. So all they're really doing is just taking a margin off the top. The issue here really is around, you know, local authorities having one contract to deal with rather than six or seven. Is that something we still have to address? I'll ask you, Joanne.
We've not had any specific feedback on that, not specifically from that sector on that issue. I'm not quite sure how that procurement piece works in terms of, obviously, I mentioned the example of the new build, which is a framework contract run by Scotland XL for all of Scotland's local authorities. But I'm not aware of any other arrangements in terms of framework contracts around that sector specifically.
Okay. No, it's just thank you. You've very well highlighted the administrative burden in bidding for public sector, especially for SMEs and newer companies. But the policies such as the quick note system has that had any impact in sort of reducing that red tape? I'll come to you, Stacey.
Definitely, quick quotes is definitely popular among our members. We've, you know, looked at, obviously it's got kind of limitations around the threshold of things that you can put through quick quotes. So we think there's definitely, it would be of benefit to expand those thresholds for quick quote to allow more contracts to be put into it.
Okay. Now, Colin, let's talk about food procurement. we've had these conversations before. I did some work in this when I first came into Parliament, nearly 8 years ago now, and when we looked at where all 32 authorities, where the food was procured from, and it's staggering. Actually, it was staggering where everything came from. You know, you alluded to, you know, ice cream from Belgium, but we're also root vegetables and, you know, potatoes from Ireland. It was, you know, and the one that the press jumped on was chicken from Thailand for some obscure reason. So it wasn't a very good picture back then. Even though there were some local authorities like East Ayrshire who were procuring 75% of food into local authorities, is the picture any better now? I don't see it at the moment. I don't see much improvement in that. But from your perspective, has that picture improved?
No, I think hopefully from the evidence that I've previously given, Brian, I don't think it has. And again, as I said, I think it's going to get worse. I'm not going to labour the point on the bread and the ice cream, but actually one of the biggest and most popular items on the school meal, and it is totally meets all the compliance, was the pizzas. And I say was the pizzas because up until, at the end of last year, 2023, The sole provider or manufacturer of those school-compliant pizzas, McCain, pulled the pizza from the market. So we now have actually no pizza on the school menus, or the one that's compliant anyway, because, again, we've not invested in local procurements, the local procurement strategy. Bizarrely, Pizzini is available in the school, and it's a Scottish producer of the Pizzini, and they could quite easily make a pizza that's compliant for the schools, but the schools require a square pizza and he makes a round pizza. And to make a square pizza involves buying more kit, moulding, and another production run, etc., which, you know, if Scottish Government were to come along and say, yep, we'll give you the money to buy that kit, happy days, the kids have their pizza again. And in the meantime, they're probably using their free bus pass to jump on the bus to go down the local high street at lunchtime to buy it from the local bakers. So, you know, we are still fixated on the price. As I said, 75% of the procurement on most of the tenders is focused on price. So when we come back to reviewing and feedback and whatnot, that's where I'm saying, actually, let's look at what that other 25% means. Actually, let's rebalance the weighting so that it is actually more about local food procurement, whole system, food systems, whole of life costs, as opposed to just that Thai chicken. And actually, on that, we are trying to work, Scottish Government doing a bit of a project on how actually we can create a demand for Scottish chicken that is price comparable to the others that are on the market. I don't know if that answered your question, Brian, fully.
No, I mean, just added in, you know, square pizzas and round plates. who can see the problem there at all? But one of the things I wanted to ask you about, and you've alluded to this as well, is the issue of price. We're focused so much on price, and the bottom line is, you know, the way in which we produce food in this country, and the proper costs associated with that, you know, even down to, you know, paying, you know, living wage and above, can make from a, if we look at price as the only or the main objective here, puts our producers at a disadvantage. So, do you think we're not looking, as you said, at the, sort of the whole life, if you like, the impact on environment of reducing, you know miles from field to fork, of the health impact of producing or offering highly nutritious food to our schools and hospitals? We're not looking at that, are we?
No, we're not. If we are looking at cost, and we do actually want to support our local supply chain and community wealth building, there are products out there that are manufactured, are available on the high street. The part of the issue is that the nutritional guidelines that schools, in this case, have to follow are too rigid, too strict. There's no flexibility. So that bread that was no longer available, the school can't just go down the high street and get something from the local Asda's or get the wholesaler to put in an alternative. You can't sub anything. You get your local delivery from your supermarket, you get an automatic sub. Might not be exactly what you want, but it's a sub, at least you've got it. Can't do that with any of these contracts. So the schools then have to go without, the kids then have to go without, because nutritional guidelines that came in 2020 are too rigid. If we actually look at them as a starting point, flex them, adjust them, or at least say to the schools, look, there is flexibility if the crap happens. If pizza is no longer available, actually, you can bring in one that's similar, might not have the same nutritional content, but you can bring in an alternative. That actually then starts to unlock some of the product that is available in the market. Even just aligning with some of the school, the English school meal regulations would unlock some of the food available in Scotland, or more specifically, maybe the UK, because there's misalignment there. There's UK producers making product for schools in England, but they don't meet the regulatory requirements for Scotland, so they can't even be produced. So there is a pizza in English schools, but can't come into Scotland.
When I allow Maggie Chapman in just now, she had some questions around price and waiting. And once, as you started that theme, I'll let Maggie pick it up and I can come back to you once Maggie's had some questions.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for what you've said so far this morning. I suppose following up from that, and it's that tension between price sustainability and the different weighting, with the sustainable procurement duty, is there a mechanism, is there a way that longer term value or longer term outcomes can be incorporated, or as it stands, is it just this is the value now, this is the weighting now? We either don't collect, or we can't collect data, or we can't project forward. I just wondered, Colin, you're talking about alternatives. If we took a longer term look, say, you know, over 5 years, are you getting these outcomes? Would that help balance some of that, do you think?
I think we need to look at what that five-year projection looks like. And in fact, you know, we're looking at everything in a five-year or a 10-year, actually, to get where we want to be in terms of the health of the of people and the everything that we're trying to do. It's actually probably going to be a generation before we actually see that real difference. But if we can actually look at getting industry involved in what's available, what is going to be required, then we can start and build the metrics around what you're asking, Maggie, because the concern is that we say, right, this is what we need now going forward, with actually working out how you're going to get there. We're going to be in the same boat again, but just with further regulation, you know, because my concern is that we're suddenly saying, well, actually, you can't bring anything in that's got a carbon footprint of X, you know, when we start to look at carbon accounting, because that actually adds more cost and disincentive for small producers who won't be able to give you that data. Yeah. And that goes back to when we're looking at Good Food Nation, but let's not be too prescriptive at the very start, because it is a worry that, you know, we start to put more regulation on top of regulation. Okay.
Stacey, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, again, and I've mentioned that a couple of times before, but I'd
expect that that's something we'll be looking at through when we get into the community wealth building legislation. The only thing that I would say is, obviously, I've kind of highlighted how much regulation compliance our members are having to deal with. So I think a key part to that is going to be actually honing in. It's very easy to fall into that trap of just collecting information for information's sake. We have to be very clear on why we are collecting information, and businesses need to understand why that's been collected rather than it just becoming another checklist for them and they're not seeing the benefit of this information being collected.
Okay. I've got another question on that, but it takes us off in another on another tangent.
Other members okay.
If I can just follow up on that then, Stacey, one of the questions I had was around the sort of broader social benefits that we're supposed to get from these procurement changes, improvements, with a focus on reducing inequality. And I'm wondering, when we're talking about collecting information, do we understand, do we government, you know, whoever, do we actually collect data in terms of what contractors are doing, what subcontractors are doing, and what their supply chains? Do we know in terms of either environmental impact, social impact, and that reducing inequality focus? Are we collecting the right data? And if not, whose responsibility? Who can kind of bring all of that together, given what you say about the burden of bureaucracy, the burden of all of the administration of all of this?
So I would say I've not heard this from members in my role at FSB. This is my previous experience. Community benefits can sometimes be kind of something that's done at the end as a kind of tick box exercise. And it's not actually demonstrable that it's had an impact on that. You know, it's like, did we go out to school and do an hour session with some pupils? You know, good, but you know, that's not having the impact you're talking about. So, but again, I would, in my experience, that's because councils don't have the adequate resources to properly contract manage that. And you know, when they're, if it's a prime subcontracting out, they'll have the sometimes not so regular meetings with them to look at progress of the contract. And you know, with that kind of focus on price, I would say things like community benefit clauses are maybe kind of further down the priority list in terms of the monitoring that they do sometimes.
Okay. And John, earlier in your comments, you've mentioned things like fair work and those kinds of things. Again, do we understand what subcontractors and, you know, secondary contractors do in a way that actually allows us to understand the genuine benefits or not of what we're trying to do?
I think I would agree with what Stacey has said. A lot of this is, you know, somebody's, you know, you're writing a bid and you think, well, what can we throw in there just to sort of try and up the scoring a little bit on some of that. So some of it does feel a little bit tick box exercise-y. I think a lot of that information is perhaps being provided. I know certainly in bids that I've been party to in a previous life before I joined the Chamber of Commerce, that information was always provided. What is done with it once it gets to a contracting authority, how it's collated, how it's analysed, and then how it's monitored going forward, don't know. So it's certainly asked for, which is one of the reasons why we've got the administrative burden that we've all discussed. It's certainly asked for, it's certainly provided, it's used in the scoring mechanism, but then it's what is done with it once it gets to that point. And I think the other thing, just to, I mean, we're completely, you know, we completely understand the fair work piece and living wage and sustainability and all that. You know, that's absolutely crucial and we completely understand that. But we have had some feedback on sometimes the proportionate nature of some of those requirements in relation to everything else that's being asked, particularly of smaller organisations and micro businesses at the lower end of the scale, and on bids which are just above the £50,000 threshold, so therefore they are by nature smaller bids. I guess the feedback is that sometimes those requests don't feel proportionate. It feels perhaps like the request is made of all bidders irrespective of size and scale. And actually, if it's a smaller bid at the smaller end of the scale, that's more likely to attract smaller businesses to apply, that a proportionality of that request should be something that's taken into account, because very often it's just not going to be commercially viable for some of these businesses to put some community wealth building elements into a very low value contract, for example. The fact that it's being potentially awarded to a smaller micro business is in itself you could argue some sort of form of community benefit. So I think that proportionality piece is something that's been fed back to us before.
So are we missing a trick, really, with especially given, you know, given the urgency with which certain issues we all need to tackle? It's no single authority or agency's responsibility. Issues like, you know, reducing inequality, like dealing with the climate emergency. Are there issues that we are missing there because we're not only asking for the wrong information or too much of certain types of information, but we're not allowing the weighting flexibility as well? So, I mean, we've talked about the 75% threshold. Would you say actually that's what needs to change if we to see some of the environmental climate emergency, you know, reducing inequality targets be much more meaningful?
I think certainly that in terms of on a wholesale, not sure if that would be the answer necessarily, but certainly perhaps on a case by case basis or a commissioning authority by commissioning authority basis, potentially that would be more manageable. I think that one of the things that we always get fed back as well is on Fair Work, it tends to focus on living wage, but there are a lot of employers out there who are doing lots of other things that actually do equate to additional money in people's pockets, perhaps not directly through wage and salary, but through things like childcare support, flexible working, all those other things. So I think some of the definitions within definitions, if that makes sense, need to be flexed a little to take into account a lot of the other things that a lot of organisations are doing that perhaps don't strictly meet that criteria as it stands at the moment. So things like that, I think there's definitely room for more engagement on that.
And when you say more engagement, with whom? What should we as a committee
suppliers
recommend?
I guess with suppliers in terms of an understanding of, and again, perhaps if there is that collating of that information that we know is being provided, and something is done with that information in terms of analysis, that might help to give some of that insight. But I think that engaging with suppliers or potential suppliers, really understanding what it is that they're doing in terms of some of the additional benefits that they're providing or the additional work that they might be engaged on, and somehow making sure that that is taken into consideration in the selection.
Thanks. Colin, if I can come back to you, because the question's moved on, are there any other things you want to say in response to?
Certainly that auditing piece, I absolutely agree with that. That, you know, it has, a lot of it has become a tick box exercise, just for tick box exercise. Say that, you know, They're appeasing the strategy or the what's being asked of them, but actually it means nothing. So there is no auditing, and that might be something that, look, if we're looking to review, to do a review of, and I mentioned about a two-stage process, maybe that second stage is actually an auditing of the paperwork, and actually is the person that's tendering actually able to deliver on, you know, what they're saying they can do. And just on, I think there's also a confusion within the local authorities themselves and not actually understanding what they're asking and not following up on the review of their tender. Because going back to your social benefits piece, one of my members won a tender. Part of that tender process was that they had to give annually funding. It's one of the largest councils in Scotland, funding towards kids' activities or something like that. That was fine. They won the tender. That money is still sitting in my member's bank account 2.5 years later. And the councillor going, oh, what? Didn't know I had that. You know, I think that says it all, really.
And my final question.
Well, maybe, Mr. Whittle, did you wish to ask another question? Because Colin Smith is up to leave quite soon.
Just one more, if I could, Convener, thank you. I have to question the nutritional value of the rules and regulations, whether they've improved the nutritional value of food in schools. But one of the things you alluded to earlier on is the difference between procuring an IT system, you know, which is one supplier supplying tens of millions of pounds worth of a service, and for your members who are, you know, individual food producers who have to go through, you know, processing of that food and, you know, with sending it away or whatever. And we've had lots of legislation since 2014 around procurement, but actually I'm not convinced it's improved anything. So does the current framework allow for the difference between that kind of procurement, sort of the big IT procurement stuff, and multiple, you know, suppliers? Because I think, again, back to my original one around, I think food procurement specifically, from a local authority perspective, it's just easier to have a single point rather than procure lots of local different produce. It can be done. We've seen it being done in local authorities. But is that something that the current framework, you know, we struggle with?
Yes, I'd certainly say that we do struggle with it. And, you know, the additional legislation that's come in, I'm not specifically know what you're referring to, but it is, there is a bureaucratic system that just adds further complexity and burden. And I think it goes back to the fact that, you know, when we're looking at these tenders, you are now in a handful of suppliers into the local authority today compared to, you know, 10 years and indeed what it could be or should be. We've got 75 wholesale food and drink distributors across Scotland, but there's only a handful supplying into the public sector. I think that says it all. It is too restrictive. It doesn't do what we want it to do. And yes, putting in, you know, computer's a computer. Yeah, food's food, but actually, you're buying one computer, but you're talking about there's 450 products that are currently sitting on the food framework through our members. It's not one food item; there's 450. In fact, there's probably more than that. 300 are core; the other 150 are to allow for the regional variations, to allow those 1,200. Adapted menus for the school. No, that was just in Tayside, three council contracts. You've got another 29 councils having to adapt their food menus to accommodate the children, the allergies, the neurodiversity in food and eating. It's complex. It really is complex. And actually, putting it into the hands of having one supplier doing it all might be the answer. But it's not going to achieve anything that we're wanting to do in local community wealth building, local jobs, employment, food security. That's not going to be achieved in the hands of one person.
Thanks. I'll leave it there. In the interest of
thank
time.
You. Maggie Chapman, did you wish to further?
Thanks very much. My last question is really, I suppose, given that we're looking at this Act 10 years on, what are the things that we would want to see, given that the world's a very different place now than it was in 2014? How, in your view, do you think we could use procurement to tackle things like the gendered nature of different employment sectors or the inaccessibility of different sectors for disabled people, whether as workers or as suppliers? Are there things that we could and should be looking at to actually make this legislation deliver the things we want for Scotland as a whole? I don't know, Joanne, if you want to kick this off.
I mean, yes, there are. There's a short answer to the question, and I think one of the things that, including requirements around sustainability and fair work and community benefits, has done is it's really shone a light on those concepts, and so a lot more businesses now are a lot more aware of them, perhaps, than they would have been, and want to comply with the requirements of those commitments. I think, though, again, I would caution, and we've talked about this a lot in terms of adding those further levels of bureaucracy. I think it has to be proportionate. It has to be considered. And I think if it's used, if it's mandated and potentially used as a stick, then all it's going to do is not encourage or dissuade more people, particularly smaller businesses, from becoming part of those procurement relationships. So I think yes is the answer, but I think that it should be done very, very carefully and in a very considered way, in consultation with the sector, and done in a way that it doesn't hinder people from participating in the process.
Okay. Thanks. Colin, I know you have to leave, so I'll come to you next and then Stephen.
Yeah, I don't think I've got much more to add. I mean, certainly I think I would hate to see more burdens on the requirement of businesses when we actually are doing everything that we can. I mean, certainly within our sector, it's very much about, you know, looking at gender equality, neurodiversity, et cetera, and that forms through our training academy to make sure that certainly our sector is doing all it can to support as wide a diverse workforce as possible. But The concern is that we then make it too prescriptive, and then you're prejudicing one over another. If one's not doing enough, but actually in that area, there isn't the employees we're talking about. It's a complex minefield.
Okay, no thanks.
I do apologise.
Yeah, no, I say obviously I've talked quite a lot about businesses being put off. We certainly don't want to put them off anymore, and I completely agree with what Joanne said. And I would say, you know, obviously I'd mentioned that the community benefit clauses is becoming a tick box. Well, we don't want to be creating a whole list of other ones where it's just tick boxes. So definitely that is something to learn from the community benefit clauses.
Okay, thanks, Tanya.
Okay, thank you. Mr Smith, you let us know in advance that you have to leave, so thank you for attending this morning. If I come to Stacey and Joanne, just a couple of questions. Maggie Chapman raised a gendered perspective on business. Do you, as organisations, collect any information on whether procurement is supporting women-owned businesses? Is it something that do you see it as being part of the procurement process? Stacey, welcome to you.
I mentioned the survey that we did this time last year, our big small business survey, so all the results that we got through that survey can be broken down by gender.
It would be interesting to share with the committee if people would like
We've
to.
We've not published that breakdown, but happy to share it with the committee.
And Joanne, is it something, because I know that in Edinburgh they have, I think you mentioned, in Edinburgh they have a subgroup that's focused on SMEs, supporting them to access contracts. I think at the beginning of the evidence session you talked about, I think it was pop-up sessions to encourage your members to look at procurement. Is there anything within that work that is focused on women-owned businesses?
Not specifically within that work. Obviously, we do a lot of work around encouraging women into business and supporting women who are already in business and women entrepreneurs. So there's a strand of work that looks at that. But there isn't anything specifically to try to encourage women-owned businesses to engage with the procurement piece. It's more about women in business more generally engaging in business and taking up entrepreneurial opportunities and using all the skills that they bring to that. So there's nothing specific around that, no.
Okay, thank you. And Stacey, can I just ask, when you talked about Fife and Clackmannan and the increases they had in local procurement, was it in, because we've had quite a long discussion this morning about food, but where was the increases in particular sectors or services that those authorities delivered?
That's not available. It's improvement service data, so they only publish the overall. They don't break it down by category.
Okay, that brings us to the end of the evidence session this morning. Thank you to the witnesses for attending. I'll now move into private session.